A Filipino factory worker has been hailed a model worker in Taiwan, leading to higher interest in the hiring of more Filipinos there. Let's hear more from Zen Hernandez.
Jeffrey Opriasa has been a factory worker in Taiwan for 12 years now. He's a solo parent, so he strives hard to give his child a better future. He's now a process engineer after being promoted twice. Last April, Jeffrey was given the National Model Worker Award by the Taiwan Ministry of Labor and was even invited to the office of Taiwan President Tsai Ing-wen, a first for a Filipino.
Ginagawa ko lang naman yung best ko na yan, huwag mag-absent, turuan yung mga katrabaho ko mag-grow. Kasi most nang dumadating, halos dumadaan sa akin para i-train ko sila.
Because of Filipino workers like Jeffrey, more Taiwanese employers want to hire Filipinos. 80% of over 154,000 overseas Filipino workers in Taiwan are working in productive industries like factories. But there are new opportunities because jobs in the services and hospitality sector will soon be offered to migrant workers.
Ngayon kasi pag tinignan mo sa hotel, walang migrant worker. Marami ng mga employers sa sector na ito na nagre-request ng authority to hire migrant workers. Mga December daw mag-a-announce na, and something like 800,000 workers.
The Manila Economic and Cultural Office, or MECO, says Taiwan is an ideal labor destination for OFWs because of the high salary. While labor issues are rare, the minimum wage for factory workers is over 26,000 new Taiwan dollars, or almost 50,000 pesos. Also in demand are English teachers. Teachers can earn 72,000 NT, or 130,000 pesos, if they pass the licensure exam. But those who have not taken the exam are also accepted. MECO also signed a memorandum of understanding with an agriculture social enterprise in Kaohsiung for the training of 100 OFWs in Taiwan.
Because, you know, they cannot stay here for a maximum of 12 years, from 3 to 12 years. And after that, they go back to our country. And with this new technology that they have learned and have been trained, they can now apply it and transfer the technology to our country.
From cultivation to food processing for the management, depends on what they need.
Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
A former Philippine Finance Undersecretary Shelo Magno believes her social media posts played a key factor in her removal from office. Magno revealed someone called the attention of Finance Secretary Benjamin Diocnez early as July about her Facebook posts supporting former Vice President Lenny Robredo, who ran for the presidency against Ferdinand Marcos Jr. But she insists her political beliefs were never in conflict with her work in the finance department, because all she wanted was to help the government craft policies to improve the lives of Filipinos.
Masyado daw akong critical kay Presidente Marcos at even the previous administration. Mm-hmm. And so I explained to Secretary Diocno that, well, yes, those are my Facebook posts. Ginawa ko yung public para makita ng Malacanang, para kilala nila kung sino ako and where I stand on issues. Hindi na nga nagmamatter actually kung sino ba yung nasa Malacanang. Dahil yung problema ng lipunan, yung problema kinakaharap natin, pareho, regardless kung sino yung nasa Malacanang. So kung may maitutulong tayo sa pag-resolve ng mga problemang ito, bakit hindi?
Magno led discussions on military pension reform. She was also pushing for higher taxes on mining.
Imbes na itaas ang tax sa mining ay ibinababa po from 5% to 3%. So taliwas po ito sa pananaw ko. Ngayon po ay kailangan natin ng karagdagang revenue sa gobyerno dahil lumalaki yung utang.
The Philippine Central Bank likely to keep benchmark interest rates unchanged in the near term. BSP Deputy Governor Francisco Dakila Jr. made that statement during the Philippine economic briefing in Dubai. He says the bank wants inflation to be within government's target range of 2 to 4% before making any moves on the policy rate.
That's also because of the need to safeguard inflation expectations, which, as I've already shown in the presentation, has been anchored to the inflation target. By that I mean that expectations coming from our survey respondents indicate that inflation will go back to within target starting next year.
The BSP's previous monetary tightening is still working its way through the economy, and the board has seen it prudent to keep a steady hand on our monetary policy levers.
Philippine headline inflation accelerated for the first time in 7 months to 5.3% in August. The central bank, which will have its rate-setting meeting on September 21st, has kept its key rate unchanged at 6.25% for the past three meetings. Southeast Asian business groups pushing to improve trade ties in the region through the creation of a new management association and shipping routes. Andrea Taguines reports.
The Philippines' biggest business group says the Association of Southeast Asian Nations should look into establishing a roll-on, roll-off shipping route to improve trading ties between member countries. Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry President George Barcelon said the route would greatly reduce logistics costs.
China has the Road Belt Initiative. ASEAN should have a roll-on, roll-off.
Barcelon said a similar system was already set up between the Philippines and Indonesia during the Duterte administration, but he said it faced challenges.
There are already plans, at least in the blueprint, connecting Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, and Thailand. If that were to be made a reality, then we can really export some of our agricultural produce to our neighboring ASEAN countries.
That's just one of the many proposals that came up about how ASEAN members can boost economic ties during the 21st International CEO Conference hosted by the Management Association of the Philippines. MAP President Benedicta Dubaladad also led the signing of a memorandum of understanding to form the ASEAN Management Association, which is aimed at fostering collaboration, cooperation, and sharing of best practices in management in the region. The other signatories were the PCCI, the Singapore International Chamber of Commerce, and the Thailand Management Association.
Even if we only have three countries coming together, that would be enough to form founding members that could spark the whole ASEAN countries having that organization together.
The SICC said the creation of the group could not have come at a better time, as it cited projections that ASEAN's economy would decline this year and the next.
Recent events have reminded us how the consequences of geopolitical dynamics are not confined to political or diplomatic realms. Whether through inflationary pressures, tightening monetary policies, fluctuating customer demand, or supply chain shortages, the knock-on effect of regional instability has a very real effect on businesses.
ASEAN Secretary General Cao Kim Horn also attended the MOU signing. He stressed the importance of increasing the level of intra-trade arrangements within the region. Barcelon echoed the same sentiments, saying he hopes the newly formed association will be a vehicle for that. He said the low intra-trade and intra-investments among ASEAN members is especially a concern for the Philippines, which suffers from a big trade deficit.
Our deficit of trade with Indonesia is close to $14 billion. Our trade with Malaysia, Thailand, and Vietnam averages about $4 to $5 billion. So just among these four countries, our trade deficit is close to about $30 billion. Hopefully that our ASEAN countries, neighbors, can see that maybe they should invest in the Philippines to reduce the trade deficit.
But Barcelon admits the problem of high operating costs is keeping foreign investors from setting up shop in the country. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Migrant Workers Department leaving it up to the Senate on how it plans to augment the agency's budget for next year. See, Senator Rafi Tulfo wants to allocate confidential funds for the DMW to help it go after illegal recruiters. The agency now says it needs additional funding, even not in the form of confidential funds, to help boost its operations. The proposed 2024 budget for the DMW is at 15 billion pesos, but nearly 12 billion pesos would go to its attached agency, the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration.
We leave it to the Senate in terms of how they would allocate the 10 million pesos that we had asked for. We also could abide by the decision of the Senate just to provide us with the 10 million pesos to boost our anti-illegal recruitment efforts. We are requesting for more funds in terms of not just the 10 million peso fund that we are requesting, but in terms of additional funds to boost our migrant workers' offices, our shelters abroad, additional financial assistance to workers in distress, and also for our regional offices.
The DMW earlier asked for some 10 million pesos in confidential funds for next year, but that was scrapped by the budget department.